Hello, I'm Mark.
And I'm Eric.
Welcome to another installment of whatever this is. What is this?
This is Two Neanderthals.
Oh, yeah.
Featuring Neanderthal 1 and Neanderthal 2.
Yeah. And if you want to know why we're called Two Neanderthals, just look at the intro, our little intro video to the channel. Today, we talked about several things, and we kind of came down on language and communication and how that seems to be working itself out in the circumstances that we find ourselves in the last couple of years with the pandemic.
And also with the ever-burgeoning realm of technology in our lives.
And technology. The way this came up originally was a comedian that's one of my favorites, Brian Regan. R-E-G-A-N, I believe is his last name. Brian Regan did this bit several years ago in one of his shows, one of his stand-up shows about language, and lazy writing is what it was. He said, for example, Adolf Hitler was rejected from art school as a young man. One thing led to another, and the United States of America dropped an atomic bomb on the sovereign nation of Japan. What? And so that one thing led to another was really the important part. Well, a good chunk of what happened in between is sort of the point that was missed in the laziness of just saying one thing led to another, which had reminded you
of a Seinfeld episode. It's the yada, yada, yada episode where, Elaine comes home from a date and she says something like, well, so we went to this restaurant, I had the bisque and yada, yada, yada. And then on my way home the next morning, and Jerry goes, well, you yada'd the best part. And she goes, no, I didn't. I mentioned the bisque.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So that night, what happened, and the next morning, all that is the yada,
gets
yada'd
yada. Over. And Mark and I were sort of musing over whether that could be sort of indicative of something going on with our linguistic practices these days in our world, our prevailing linguistic practices.
Mm-hmm. And the way that a lot of the social media even has its own shorthand, texting especially, and a lot of there's sort of an isolation that seems to take place in a lot of these I could jump straight to my story about the professor and his daughter with the TikTok.
Sure, go for it.
So somehow, I think he was a college professor. I saw this article a few weeks ago. He was flabbergasted with this conversation he had with his teenage daughter about Helen Keller. Because, I don't remember how it came up, but anyway, in conversation, it came up and she goes, oh, well, Helen Keller wasn't a real person. And he said, what do you mean she wasn't a real person? Well, because no one that was blind and deaf would have ever been able to do the accomplishments that she had with the awards and the acclaim and the achievements. It just wouldn't be possible. So apparently, he started investigating this a little bit online with a TikTok. There's a kind of a subgroup or whatever they call it of TikTokers that believe that Helen Keller, some of them believe, some of the groups believe she wasn't real at all. And then the others that do believe she was an actual person don't believe she was really had those disabilities.
Mm-hmm. So it's a conspiracy kind of thing.
It is. And it seems to be, the reason I brought it up is because it's sort of an example of the yada yada and the one thing led to another phenomenon.
Yeah. And I think you mentioned also like the proliferation of these acronyms like IDK and things like that, that, you know, as those things sort of proliferate in our speech becomes much more oriented toward the soundbite and much less oriented toward you know, full sentences with subjects and predicates that are part of paragraphs, which in turn are part of chapters. That whole way of using language that's narratively structured begins to slip away,
yeah,
right? And much more gets sort of falls into the lacuna of the yada, yada, yada.
Yeah. And so there is, it's that serves to do a few things. One is it serves to isolate certain, it makes a sort of a cliquish kind of clannish environment, especially online and social media, where if you're not part of that group, you can't understand really what's going on. And I also think it serves to exacerbate the speed at which we live life.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that's a chicken or an egg kind of an
right,
analogy.
Right, it's hard to tell. It's probably both dynamics. Like the yada, yada, yada is increasing the rapidity, and the rapidity motivates the yada,
yeah,
yada, yada,
yeah,
at the same time. So there's a cyclicity to it. But I agree with you that a lot of the yada, yada, yada is about rapidity and desiring communication to happen relatively quickly. Like, we don't feel like we have time to sit around for paragraphs and chapters and books and things like that. And I think part of that has to do with impatience, right? The phenomenon of impatience.
And that leads to the increase, what seems to be a great increase in road rage and the fighting on the airplanes over, you know, even assaulting the flight attendants. And speaking of flying, see, I grew up in a flyover state of Kentucky, in a rural part of Kentucky, a small farm. And life seemed to me, when I was a child, it was slow. Everything took its time. My grandfather, who I spent a lot of time with as a kid growing up, helping him on the farm, I don't ever remember him being in a hurry to do anything. And neighbors would come over on Sunday afternoon and sit in the backyard, and they would drink tea. And, you know, it would just be, it took its time. The conversation, the yada, yada, and the one thing led to another. Those were the main parts of the conversation. Nothing was skimmed over and abbreviated.
Yeah.
And I think that we're kind of losing, you know, it's to our detriment that we don't do that anymore.
Yes, like we're losing something along the way. And I think that part of another thing that's going on with that is besides losing part of life that we would share with each other as a function of our impatience to get through the conversation is I think we're losing a sense for what it is to live in a state of psychological abundance. Mm-hmm. And by that, what I mean is a basic sense that life is already sufficient. Life is already good. Life is already satisfying, and that we therefore don't need to speed our way through the next conversation or fly into a rage on the roads because someone didn't use a turn signal. I think that those sorts of phenomena become more prevalent when we're living in a state of psychological scarcity rather than psychological abundance. And what I mean by psychological scarcity is that a basic pervasive sense that the good in life is somehow elusive or difficult to get a hold of, or we don't have enough of it, or that our souls are in some way starving for what is really good and deep and meaningful and fulfilling about life. And then in the face of that, we're in a big impatient hurry to get through things. And you mentioned earlier, Mark, that really where we're going in all of the impatient rush is nowhere.
Yeah. And where are we headed with all of this rush that we're in?
Well, ultimately, we're headed to the grave.
Yeah.
Like, we're rushing to get into our graves more quickly. Woohoo! Rock on for that. But the reason why we're going nowhere, another take on it would be that, you know, a lot of the things that we're trying to get to probably don't seem all that necessary, all that satisfying, or all that important, or all that significant. Why? Because we're living in a state of psychological scarcity rather than psychological abundance.
And one of the things that that happens with that is the rage that comes out. There's, as you mentioned, there's a difference in rage and anger.
Yeah.
But the rage that comes out is just generally directed at nothing or no one in particular. It's sort of a unspecified, and you see it in the news. Of course, the news is hyperbole and sensationalism because they want to sell advertising. But for example, the stories that you see periodically of just some old lady walking down the sidewalk in New York City, and somebody comes up behind her, just knocks her unconscious, and sometimes even kills them, you know, for absolutely, completely, thoroughly no reason except for this undefinable feeling of rage or
I want.
Yeah.
Is the other part of it.
Yeah.
Sometimes that's a function of robbery or, you know.
And sometimes there's nothing. They just knock them down and they just keep going.
There was some kind of game about that, like knocking people out on the streets or something.
Mm-hmm.
Is that was the knockout game or something?
Yeah. And that was actually a thing. And I just, yeah. I'm sure it has its own little group on one of those Snapchats or TikToks or things. But it's the other thing is the last 2 years in particular has served to exacerbate all of this, I think, in the isolation that we all feel.
Right. I agree that, you know, the separation and the isolation and the generalized weirdness of living in the age of COVID, I think, has contributed significantly to our state of psychological impoverishment or scarcity. And on the other side of the coin, made attaining any kind of sense of fulfillment or psychological abundance a lot more difficult, or at least it seems a lot more difficult to us. But there again, it's like we're noticing a set of dynamics that are seemingly only getting worse. Perhaps, you know, maybe an upbeat take on it would be, well, you know, once we get over COVID a little bit, that maybe we can, part of what will hopefully return, although the jury's out on that, I think, would be more of a pervasive sense of psychological abundance, more the sense that life is good fundamentally, and that we don't need to be flying into these infantile rages. By the way, one of the differences between anger and rage has to do with the degree of focus. Mm-hmm. Okay, so anger, you're angry at something or someone. It's fairly tightly focused, whereas rage is much more diffusely focused. Like, it's hard to say what you're really angry at. The person who flies into a homicidal rage because someone didn't use a turn signal is probably not angry as such at the lack of a turn signal. What's really going on is that the turn signal is a trigger for something much more generalized and much more diffusely focused, which is a more generalized, I think, sense of existential vacuum, is what Viktor Frankl calls it, like the sense that there's not much that's really meaningful or really significant going on in our lives that would, you know, pull us beyond the domain of our petty self-involvement and self-importance.
And I think one of the remedies might be, and sometimes it's harder than it would appear on the surface, but it might be to move with the intention of slowing down, even if it's just a period. Joseph Campbell said, you should have an hour every day when you don't know what time it is. You don't know what the weather is outside. You don't know what the news stories headlines are. You just take your, you had mentioned earlier that you have a meditation spot in your house there.
Right.
And it doesn't have to be a particular spot. It can just be just sitting still and quiet and just pondering basically the living of life and taking those just a few moments to not be aware and absorbed and consumed by anything external.
Yeah, and I would agree that that would be a wonderful countervailing force to a lot of the malaise we're experiencing and existential vacuum and all of that kind of stuff. But here's the problem. Everything in our world would count against that.
Yes.
Everything in our world, practically everything in our world, would move us in the exact opposite direction. For instance, your phone went off.
Yeah,
my few phone minutes ago.
We
live in a world of dingers and buzzers and phones, and you know, we're all sort of tethered to this world of
technology,
and more importantly, distraction by way of technology that would pull us out of whatever sort of moment you might have or space. I agree, Mark. I'm agreeing with you. Like, it would be a wonderful corrective, I think, to a lot of the woes that are plaguing our world these days. But I think by the same token, man, let's not underestimate the challenge of it.
You know, it might be a good follow-up video to do on the way that the very things we've created to make life more efficient, the use of our time more efficient, are also the very things that are serving as tools, as an impediment to our abundance, the psychological abundance that we could have.
Yeah, well, there are very few things in this world, I would say, that are either purely boon or purely bane. All right, there are very few things. And when we're dealing with something as large and encompassing as technology and pervasive as technology, it's bound to be infused with both boons and banes. The boons are fairly obvious, I think, that we can communicate more easily and more rapidly, and there's an excitement about that. And I'm excited too, as a boomer, a late boomer. We're both late boomers.
Yep.
Like, we're excited. I mean, we are like stoked. We are like totally pumped about it. But by the same token, I think it would be exceedingly unwise to overlook the banes.
It's challenging. And even while we're doing this, in my mind, I'm multitasking. I'm thinking of the four or five things that I have to do the minute we're done with this.
Yeah.
And instead of being able to be here, present fully in the moment.
And in fact, we're both a little under the gun. I keep looking at the screen because I'm looking at the clock.
Yeah.
Another sign of the times, man. Another sort of rapidity.
We don't want to make the video too long.
Yeah.
Because people will lose their attention and go to something else.
That's true, too. But also, you have other things to do. Yeah. So we're a little time pressured. We actually started this video earlier, and then the computer crashed, and we totally lost the file. So now we feel we're sucked into the very dynamics we're trying to describe in the video. Like, we might have to yada part of the video. Yeah. We'll probably yada the best part of the damn video.
One thing led to another.
Right? And here's the end of the video. Ta-da.
So, speaking of that, maybe we should let this one go before we lose. My computer shut down, and I don't want that to
happen. I know.
Happen
so we're both nervous about it because we ran. What did we run? Like 14 minutes or something?
Yeah,
and the thing
and we
like
lost all of
crashed. So we'll leave you with under 20 minutes.
And maybe we can do a part two on this one. I think there's plenty.
Oh, I think so. This is very fertile ground.
Element.
Yeah. And I think you all know, or maybe some of you know, that I came from the world of technology. And you know, before my last regeneration, I had a life in technology as a software engineer before I got interested in psychology and philosophy and being a professor and all that stuff. So the talk about the meaning of technology and how it's shaping our lives to me is a topic very near and dear to my heart. Yeah. All right, we got to keep it under 20. Keep it under 20.
We'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.
Yes, thanks for hanging along for the ride. And take care of yourselves.
See you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.